Good morning. We got a lot of people still coming in. This place was packed first service. I think when Christmas rolls around, people get in here early, but it's look coming there. Okay. It's good to see everybody this morning. I want to go ahead and make two or three announcements before we enter our worship time. First one is this shirt I'm wearing is several ask about shirts with the church name on them. We've not done that for a couple of years or so I'm your pretty model. But this is what's available in burgundy and blue, and then there's a short sleeve polo type. They're really good shirts. It won't be this one. But they do make some rotund if you need them. They're at the visitor center. Tammy will be back there if you want to look at them and order one. There's just one of each, and you can see what you want, pick a color. You done, Jimmy, insulting me? Okay. Also, announcement, this Wednesday night will be the children's program. So that should be in the bulletin. That will be a fantastic program. So come and be a part of that and help be a part of the Christmas program. You're going to really enjoy that. I want to make another announcement. Next week is our congregational meeting after this service. And what the congregation members all do is we have a real light meal, this cold cuts and all, and not real long meeting, but we need to ask the congregation to approve the budget, confirm the budget, and also the slate of leaders for next year, elders and deacons, as will be put before you by the current elders. So please stand to be a part of that. Stand to be a part of it. It's a good way to learn a lot about the church. Also, it's a very sad note this morning that I want everyone to know, a lot of them maybe already heard, but Abraham Thomas passed away early yesterday morning our time, and that's sad news. If you knew Abraham, as many of you did, and he's our representative of this church and of his people and ultimately of God in South India, and that church grew from him on the street corner to 14, 15,000 people or more now. But he passed away from cancer early yesterday morning, and God is good. We Skyped him Friday night, and we're able to have a great visit with him. Did not anticipate this coming like it did yesterday, but his daughter Steffi flew over yesterday. Sneha, his other daughter, is here. Of course, Valsa, his wife, was there with him, but Sneha will not be able to go over because of commitments. We will have a memorial service for Abraham here at the church next Saturday at 11 in the morning, and want to invite all of you and him to come and be a part of that. We really want to honor him, and that, of course, will be videoed for Valsa and the family to have over there. So just please thank God for him in your prayers, and that he's in a better and much grander place now than we. How many of you enjoy Christmas? Okay, how many of you enjoy Christmas music? Might be a better question. I love listening to Christmas music. Jill starts April and listens and quits sometime in February. So March is no Christmas at our house. But I love Christmas music, and there's a lot of grand music that we don't sing in church that we all enjoy. So we've asked the band this morning if they would do a Christmas song for us. It's one of my favorite. And the words will be up. Join in and sing if you want to, but it's one of my favorite Christmas songs. And so in church this morning to start, we're going to sing Jingle Bell Rock. Everybody ready? We're going to have fun this morning. And then we'll have a word. Let's pray now. This is worship. Let's pray now. Let's have a word of prayer and then Jingle Bell Rock, okay? God, thank you for just being Christian, the joy we can have being together today. Father, we praise you for this time. We praise you that we can bring these songs before you as an act of worship from joy from our heart. Father, thank you for this season as we enter into it. We pray this, we pray it together in the precious name of Jesus, your Son. All God's people say it. Amen. Something you never heard in church before, ladies and gentlemen, Jingle Bell Rock.
Jingle bells ring, Throwing and blowing up bushels of fun. Now the jingle has begun. Jingle bell, jingle bell rock. Jingle bell time and jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing in Jingle Bell Square. In the frosty air. What a bright time, it's the right time to rock the night away. Jingle bell time, it's the thrill time to go gliding in one horse and lay. Oh yeah, jingle bells, pick up your feet. Jingle all around the clock. Mix and mingle and jingle and beat. That's the jingle bell rock.
Let's pray together.
God, we are thankful that we get a chance to come together just to enjoy each other's company, to fellowship, to grow. And God, just to sing fun songs. We're glad, God, that you have brought us together, that you bind us in unity through your Son, the one who is we're celebrating here. Who remind us of his birth, his death, his resurrection. We praise you, Lord, for that. We're thankful, God, that for your grace and for your love that you came to this earth. We're thankful, God, for the love that you have shown us. So, Lord, we raise these songs up to you. We raise our voices in praise. We raise our, this is our anthem as just joy. We pray that your Spirit is present here, Lord. And God, that you are present here always. But make it easy, at least for us, to see you, the work that you are doing. Lord, we are thankful. And it's in your holy name that we pray. Amen.
Savior reigns. When all their
songs employ, while fields and floods. Sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. Sing joy, joy, unspeakable joy, and overflowing well. No tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, never lets me go. And He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nation the glories of His righteousness, and wonders of His love, and wonders of His love, and wonders, wonders of His love. Sing joy. Joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well, no tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, rises in my soul, never lets me go.
Did say was to search and poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep. And Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. They looked up and saw a star shining in the east, beyond them far, and to the earth it gave great light, and so it continued both day and night.
Noel,
Noel, Noel, Noel, born is the King of Israel. And Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. Thank you.
above all powers, above all kings, above all nations and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. You were here before the world began.
Sing above.
Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you were. Sing Noel. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. Noel, born is the King of Israel.
May be seated.
Simply, the Lord's Supper is a time for all of us to look back. A reminder of what Jesus did in the past. Look forward. A promise of what He will do in the future. And to look inward, a symbol of our present relationship with Him. I'm going to begin reading this morning from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting at verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The Lord's Supper looks back to the death of Christ on a cross. The table here before you has carved into it, "This do in remembrance of me." Jesus' death shows how much God loves us, so much that He sent His Son to die for us, so that our sins may be forgiven and we may live forever with Him. We remember Jesus' death. We also remember that Jesus was dead for only 3 days. We rejoice that Jesus has conquered death, and our mourning turned to joy. As Christians, we look back to the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus as a defining moment in our faith. Now, as we continue reading at verse 25, in the same way, after he took supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death." Whenever we partake of these emblems, we are looking into the future, reminding us of Jesus' promise to us that we will live with Him and have everlasting life. This is how we escape death and the slavery of sin. And this is how we are freed to serve the Lord. As we continue reading at verse 27, "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment upon themselves." The Lord's Supper reminds us that real life is found in Jesus Christ, with Him living in us. When we are aware that Jesus lives in us, we allow Him to change our lives so that we live as He wants us to. So as we hold the body and the blood of Christ in our hands here this morning, let's simply look back in remembrance. Look forward in thanksgiving. And look inward in discipleship.
Pray. Father God, we thank You that we can come around this table. We can remember the sacrifice, Father, that You made for each of us through Your Son, Jesus. Father, we thank You for Your love and Your grace and Your mercy. Father, help us to remember to live that simple life, to simply follow You, to be Your disciple. And don't let all the other stuff and obligations get in the way, but just keep us focused upon You and forgive us when we don't put You first. We ask now that You bless this cup and this loaf. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to You today to thank You for Your grace and to please help us deepen our faith and recognize the needs of humanity so that we may better serve our fellow people. We ask this through Jesus' name. Amen.
One of the joys of ministry is to get to meet different people. I've had the privilege this Christmas of meeting a real celebrity, and I want you to meet him. Let me introduce to you Mr. Elf on the Shelf. So, Mr. Elf on the Shelf, is it okay if I call you Mr. Elf?
I mean, you can, but my friends call me Chippy.
Chippy, I bet you're really busy this time of the year, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, real busy. Uh-huh.
Chippy, what does Christmas mean to you?
Well, to me, Christmas is about tradition. It's also about family. In my line of work, I get to see a lot of really neat families. Except for the Clark family in Carter County. I'm going to need therapy. But I think one of the neatest things I get to see is when a family has the real Christmas story at the center of their celebration. Especially the birth of Christ. That's my favorite. They always have a real deep joy within them.
Chippy, I really don't know who the boss of an elf in his work is. I suppose you have one. But have you ever had a boss that made you do anything you didn't want to do?
Yes. Yes, I have.
Don't forget, this Wednesday night is the children's program, and I just had a thought. I think following the program, how many of you think it'd be a good idea if the kids had their pictures made with Chippy? That probably won't be happening Wednesday night. We did that because in a staff meeting, I finally figured out who he looked like. And in all seriousness, I want you to enjoy Christmas. I want you to enjoy Christmas. We packed 100,000 meals yesterday to feed the hungry. And I was absolutely blown away last night when social media exploded with attacks on what we did. I couldn't believe it. And it served as a reminder to me, knowing what I was going to talk about today especially, that there are people who are against everything and far very little. If you'll allow me to say it for the church, there is that phrase that says you are damned if you do and you are damned if you don't. And I want us to be people that at Christmas are doing, are absolutely doing for other people. I want to talk a little bit about Familiar Christmas, and that's seriously why I thought Elf on the Shelf would be a good way to introduce this morning. But I want you to think about a lot of the tradition of Christmas. There was a man who lived, he was Greek, he was a bishop of Myra, a city, and he became known for his acts of kindness to the poor, is what's made him live in memory for so long. His name was Saint Nicholas. He died in the mid-300s. But what he was known for doing at certain times was he would find where the poor were living or knew the poor in the community, and he would drop a coin or a little gift of value in their shoes where they had to set their shoes while they would sleep at different times. He endeared himself to many people because they were greatly impoverished. So that when he died on December the 6th, it became known as the St. Nicholas Day. We still see it on calendars today. But I want you to think what that created. It created the practice that was taught to young children if they would hang a stocking on St. Nicholas Day, like we have them hanging, and this one fell in the floor, that there possibly would be a gift the next day, a coin, a something of value given to them in honor of St. Nicholas. There was a group of people who came to help found this country, the Dutch. And they founded a colony in our country that they named New Albany. Or New Amsterdam, I'm sorry. New Amsterdam. You've heard of it. The name changed, and it's known as New York. They brought with them the story of St. Nicholas, whose name had been changed and gone through the evolution of the name and the transliteration in different languages, so that they came to this country and spoke about Sinterklaas. One word, Sinterklaas. And it became Americanized to Santa Claus. Hold on to that piece of information. December the 6th. Centuries ago, the Romans would celebrate that the shortest day of the year, as far as light was concerned, was behind them, and they were looking forward to the spring. Their celebrations were very, very pagan, very wicked, filled with debauchery. A large number of the Roman citizens had become Christians by that time, a century or so after Jesus had lived. And they made the decision that over and against that which was evil, they would claim that day as a day of worship. And so they begin to meet on December the 25th every year and celebrate a worship service. A mass was the term they used, called Christ Mass. And every year, it would be a recognition on their calendar of the birth of Jesus. They did not claim it to be a birthday. They claimed it to be a day of worship centered around the birth of Christ as they looked forward to the new year coming. The Romans had taken the practice as their own of getting evergreens and using those evergreens in their debauchery and in their worship of the sun gods. And so some of the Christians said, we can do the same and begin to say it's the birth of life. And the evergreen represents life, the coming of warmth, the coming of spring and of new life. So they begin to use the evergreen in some of their worship. They took what was evil and turned it into something that was good through their hearts and changed minds. What do we celebrate Christmas with? Christmas trees, evergreens. The Germans brought those to this country. It is a myth that Martin Luther was the first one to ever have the idea, The Germans brought the use of the evergreen, and it's changed very little over the years to set a tree in one's home. But it didn't catch on for 100 years or so. It was even looked at with disdain in our country, so much so that the New York Times wrote a rather lengthy editorial condemning the use of Christmas trees. And our president at the time, Teddy Roosevelt, came out and made a speech, an announcement against Christmas trees, using the logic that to cut a Christmas tree was to threaten the lumber industry. We've not always been known for paying attention to our presidents, have we? And thus most everyone sitting here today probably has a tree in their home already. It only became natural that Sinterklaas and the giving of gifts would be married with Christ's Mass and the worship of God, so that on December the 25th, we celebrate Christmas. I've heard a lot about Christmas in the last few years, people attacking it. But I've also heard Christians attack back, which is not good. We should celebrate the birth of the Christ child. Celebration, joy, hope lived out is what attracts people to the gospel of Christ. We've spoken of his life all this year. And I want us to read some scriptures today that are familiar to us in the story of Christmas, but just a few of the scriptures. And what I hope we can do is crawl inside the emotion of what was really happening that time when he was born. Most scholars will say it was in the spring or in the fall when it really happened that he was born. And they say that by statements like the shepherds were out in the fields and different things and knowing the shepherding practice of that area. But we celebrate the birth as a worship, no matter what day, just as we celebrate the death and the resurrection every Sunday when we come around the table. We celebrate the birth. If we go in Walmart, we're there to celebrate the birth. Act accordingly. If we're in the mall, we're there to celebrate the birth. If we go to see Christmas lights or putting our tree up, for Christians, we have the joy of knowing that is the worship of an eternal God. Now, let's listen to some of these scriptures. I start in Luke 2, verse 5. Joseph and Mary were traveling for the census. The census would take place, which is always attached to a tax. They were very poor. They were pledged to one another to be married. I'll simplify that by saying it was a form of an engagement. They were to be and understood by law to be sexually pure, but she was pregnant. Joseph, it tells us, you know the story, had wished to divorce her, to put her away. He did not want to humiliate her. He did not want her to be judged and found wanting and possibly face death, which could have happened. But there was an angelic divine messenger that came to Joseph and told him who this child would be. But it didn't save them humiliation. It didn't save them the difficulty. Nobody would believe that story. They held it in their hearts. And we pick up the story about him going to be counted. It says he went there to register government action with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting child. Their situation would have been frowned upon by many. It was not a joyous time for them, but a very scary time. And verse 7 in this chapter says, she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. We like to think of it as a full Holiday Inn. But it was probably a family dwelling, some distant relatives maybe. And they went there to stay, as would have been the custom, and the homes would have been very small. They wouldn't have had room for everybody. Had to come back to this hometown where they were commanded to go by law. And so they stayed where there was a manger. They stayed in an offshoot, a room, a place there would have probably been some animals. And she gave birth. I want everybody to think about Mary for a second at this point. Joseph's here. So-and-so's son. Go got his wife-to-be with him. She's already pregnant. And she's away from her family. Mother wouldn't be there to attend the birth. And she's with these distant in-laws and gives birth to this baby. How would she have felt, ladies? How would she have felt? And would anybody believe her story so it wouldn't even be told? The story goes on about the angels and how the angels went to the shepherds. And that had to have been a hard, hard, boring life. Every day, 7 days a week, tending to these sheep. Every day, 7 days a week, generation after generation, week after week, month after month. And suddenly these angels appear. Something's happening that's never happened before. And it scares them. It scares them silly. It would scare anybody. And the first thing the angel has to do is say, calm down. We're not here to destroy you. We're not here to judge you. We're here to give you the news of the greatest thing that's ever happened. You won't totally understand it now. But the Savior of the world's being born. And we're telling you, there is hope. There can be joy. You're living at the most pivotal moment of history. And God wants you to know that. So the angels left, and the shepherds said to one another in verse 15, let's go to Bethlehem, let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. They don't fully understand it, but they take it in, and they go to worship. They go to worship. And then it tells us, but Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. I want you to think about when children are born in our lives today. It's been no different over the years. It's changed a little bit maybe how we celebrate it. I'm the third child, if you'll be my psychiatrist for a minute. I'm the last one. They made four pictures of me in 19 years. My brother Robert, the oldest, grew up in a shrine. Day one, snap. Day two, snap. Oh, isn't he cute? Day three, third one's born. Put him in there, we'll go. He'll be okay till we get back. Some of you know what I mean. Feel better having got that off my chest. But here's Mary with her firstborn. And the circumstances around it all seem tragic. But God said, I'm bringing some people to worship your kid. Mary, I'm going to be there with you. It's going to be hard. It's going to be hard, hard, hard. But I'm going to be there with you. When it says she treasured these things up in her heart, it wasn't a baby shower. It wasn't all these beautiful little photographs or Jesus burped today or, you know, my son smiled for the first time. Oh, those joys were there, I'm sure, for any mom. But this mother had to have more fear in her heart than any mom's ever had. What does this mean? What does this mean? We see the nativity scenes everywhere. It's interesting. I think sometimes it's almost abusive of the story. And I don't mean that mean, but I remember I was the janitor at the church growing up with my brother when I was in high school, and he's an older brother. He made $35 a week and paid me $3, and I thought that was fair. That's abuse of the younger one again. But part of our job every year was to set up the life-size nativity scene. And we got in trouble with our boss one time, my dad, because we also were to fire the furnace. And I cut up part of the nativity barn, just kindling to start the furnace. But anyway, we decided one day, because the church is along a busy highway, that I would go stand in the nativity scene with the broom. So there I stood with the wise men, watching cars slow down. We got in trouble because of that too. But all of our nativity scenes have the three wise men in it. Doesn't say three anywhere. You've heard that before. We hear gold, frankincense, and myrrh and attribute it to three. How many of you were here Wednesday night and saw our three wise men? Mark Norman is the tallest wise man I've ever seen. He told me he came in on a one-hump camel, and when he was left, it was two-hump. He's a tall man. But these wise men come to worship sometime in the first or second year, not on Christmas morning as we depict it. And they come to worship, and Herod hears about it, and Herod's very jealous of his power, jealous of his kingdom. And when he talks to them and they say, there's this special person's been born, we've come to see, we've followed this beautiful star. Herod says, oh, I want to know, I want to go worship him too. Tell me about it when you find him. And they were led to not go back to Herod by God to protect that child. And so listen to this part of the Christmas story found in Matthew 2. It says, when Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the wise men, the magi, he was furious. And he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning. This is the birth of Jesus. Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more. But he'd gotten Joseph and Mary out of town so Jesus wouldn't be killed. I want you to think about that for a minute. Scholars vary in the numbers they think, but there were a lot of babies killed. I remember as a young man, when so many were being drafted for Vietnam, and my oldest brother was of draft age, and it was a constant worry for families. And a longtime friend of my mother, who's been gone a long time now, as has been my mom, a neighbor came and knocked on the door. And mom greeted her to the door, as they would often do and visit. And the lady began to scream and curse my mother because her son had just been drafted and my mom's had not yet. I remember it being horrible to hear it. Horrible to hear what was going on at that door. As a 9-year-old boy. Can you imagine a community that looked at Mary and Joseph and Jesus and said, why is he alive and all the others are dead? My boy's dead. And can you imagine the things they begin to say and what they begin to figure out and say, why did my little boy have to die so that yours will live? And that tells me that in the midst of the celebration of Christmas and the joy and the hope and the birth of that Christ child, that right in the middle of it was evil. Evil constantly hammering, trying to destroy everything of God. And we live in that today. And how do you fight evil? Not with evil. Not with argument, not with belittlement, but you fight evil with the overwhelming power of the love of God winning one person at a time. And that's what we're called to do. We're not called to go into the stores and say, Merry Christmas. I said it. We're called to embrace the world and love them. Called to embrace the world and love them. And I'll tell you something that is the truth. The church will do better in the minority than it's ever done in the majority. Because we'll have to believe and stand for what we believe that's good about God. One of the attacks on social media last night toward the church and toward me was this question from hell. Why are you feeding Muslims? by sending food to starving children in Haiti and Nicaragua. God, forgive that type of question. And God, forgive us when we don't celebrate Christmas. Agree or disagree with me, that's your freedom, obviously. And I won't say I'm right and you're wrong, but I'm going to tell you something about David Clark. I love Santa Claus. I love the elf on the shelf. I love the birth of the Christ child that we get to celebrate. I look forward to driving all day Christmas Day to go see my grandchildren. As long a day as it'll be. I look forward to being able to celebrate that there is hope in the midst of sin. And I want to challenge us as a church, as we've talked about the life of Christ in so many details for the whole year, I want to challenge you to go out and celebrate the birth of that Christ child. Put the tree up in worship. I remember the obligatory sermons being told when we were children, don't enjoy Christmas too much. Enjoy it as an act of worship to God. Not as things, but as an act of worship to God. And I praise God that somehow this day was made special so that the world can see the hope of Christ through the church. Through the church. So let me close the sermon by saying this. Merry Christmas. Turn to your neighbor and say it in joy. Merry Christmas. May hope and the God of hope dwell in your heart throughout the next few weeks of this season. We're going to sing a song, a response to worship. We're going to sing a song. If there'd be any decision, a public decision anybody'd want to make, I'll ask you to come forward. But as we prepare for that, let's go to God in a word of prayer. God, we thank you for worship. We thank you for the birth of a child that we mentioned today. And God, maybe for the first time, we understand there was difficult times when that child was born. The world was not all happy. And God, that evil was threatened and a hold was being broken. But God, we've been set free, that there was a resurrection, that there was a cross, a bloody cross that was tied to that day, that Father was introduced in the death of children. But you know, God, they're with you. And they were better off than anybody that lived. They're with you. Maybe the first martyrs of the birth of Christ. God, help us to be people who are positive about the message, people who are full of joy with each other, hope with each other. And Father, please work in that hope, we beg you, to help others to be attracted to the love and the joy of Christ. Father, we give this day, this week that's coming to you, and we pray this in Christ's holy and precious name. I'm going to ask you to stand. If there be any decision this morning, to please come.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace. When fears are stilled, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, sad Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Before we close, I pray this week we'll all face temptation, that we'll remember this story. We leave here as repentant sinners, and that we'll face with a new boldness what Christ did for us and his hope. John, I'm going to ask you to come up. I want to recommend something to you. I said I like Christmas. Jill and I went last night to the Natural Tunnel. They've got it lit up and a nice ride for kids and adults. Everybody would enjoy it. So I'd like to encourage you to go up and see the lights on a Friday or Saturday nights when they do it, I think. Jill and I left here at the church yesterday about 5:30 to go, and we got caught behind a wreck going through Weber City. That's real frustrating. And got up and there set the car, and I thought, this big dummy needs to learn to drive better. He got in my way tonight and bothered me. But we went on. I didn't see any need to stop and help him, but we went on. But I would encourage you to go. John, you want to close in prayer?
And if you go home and read the story of the Good Samaritan, if you want to.
Okay, try again. Okay, let's pray. Father God, as we enter into this holiday season, let us just be filled with the joy of thanksgiving in our hearts. As we take a minute and around the stillness of this place and the lights of the trees and the red of the flowers, and Father, we can get so caught up in the trappings of Christmas that we tend to lose sight of the meaning of it. And so today, Father, we just pray that you have been pleased with our introduction. You have been pleased with our beginning of our celebration. And so as we celebrate your birth, let us never forget that you came to die. And celebrate that as well. We just pray all these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before you leave, I don't want that story to be out there.
Brutal guy. Tell them what happened, John.
We were standing in the cold, and this preacher drove by. I mean, that's for 3.5 hours. No.
Go in peace. Sorry.